I got excited when I read the scriptures because of the kind of things that the Lord shows me. And I pray that I'll be able to pass on some of those things to you tonight. Amen? Praise the Lord. Particularly when you are going to teach on the book of Acts, which is one of those fantastic books of the Bible. Very exciting, pacey book of the Bible. Amen. Okay, let's start with a prayer. Praise God. Let me agree with what Pastor Fo has been praying. Father, we agree with what has been said in the name of Jesus. We pray for your supreme grace to reign as we look into your word. Your word will do us good tonight in the name of Jesus. Your word will transform us. Your word will uplift us. Paul said, I commit you to the word of grace that is able to build you up and give you an inheritance amongst the saints. Thank you for our inheritance that we step into today as we hear your word in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. So we're gonna look at the book of Acts today. Summary about the book. How many of us really like the book of Acts? You enjoy the book of Acts. Praise God. Wonderful book. Wonderful, wonderful book. So the book of Acts actually covers 30 or 32 years, even though it doesn't seem so. When you're reading it, you're going from what happened in the church in Jerusalem, you move to what happened to the apostles, you move to Paul's conversion. It seems like the next day, and then the next day. No. It's a period of 32 years. So some of the events that took place in the beginning may not have been exactly how God wanted it. For example, Dorcas dies, they wash her body, put her upstairs, go to call Peter. Is that really what God wants? But it's better than burying her. It's almost as though we've regressed now. But the Lord is moving us forward in Jesus' name. Amen? But God would have expected them, the disciples, to have prayed. So you see some of the things that happened in the early church, but it's years. It's 32 years. Some of the revelations that Paul had writing all those letters is many, many, many years. So don't look at the life of Paul and say, well, I've been born again for 5 years or 10 years. Where have I been? No, some of the revelations that Paul had was after 20 years. Not only what he had when he saw the Lord. So he also tells us really, the book of Acts is about how Christianity spread, I said, from Jerusalem to Africa. Who took the gospel to Africa? The Ethiopian eunuch. Ethiopian eunuch took the gospel to Africa. Then gospel in Rome. So you find out how the gospel spread from the book of Acts. And also, of course, the work of the Holy Spirit. We'll look at that a bit closer today. Then we also learn from the book of Acts, that salvation is not only for the Jews, it's for us too, the Gentiles. Were you a Gentile? Jew. Every non-Jew by birth is referred to as a Gentile. And of course, how the church became successful. Then of course we learn about the religious persecutions and how Christianity affected men and women from every sector of the society. Whether you're rich or poor, do you know about a woman called Damaris? Did you read about Damaris in your Bible? It's there. What about Onesimus? It's there in your Bible. Male or female? What about Sergio Paulus? Who was Sergio Paulus? Did you read that in the book of Acts? Well, Sergio Paulus was one of the governors in the book of Acts that Paul went to visit. Then there were also very prominent men, prominent women that got saved. So we've always said that even people who are prominent still need salvation too. Then we can ask, who wrote the book? Well, we know it's Luke who wrote the book. Who did he write the book to? There's a similarity between the book of Acts and the book of Luke. Addressed to? Who is the book of Luke and the book of Acts addressed to? Thank you. Theophilus, it says that in verse 1. Read verse 1 for me, somebody, please. Yeah?
Theophilus.
Oh, Theophilus, yeah.
I wrote about all that Jesus began to do.
And to teach.
And to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven.
Thank you.
After giving instructions to the Holy Spirit, to the apostles he has chosen.
Yeah. After appearing to them for a period of 40 days, over a period of 40 days, they saw Jesus over a period of 40 days. So we know that the book was written to Theophilus. Why do you think the book of Acts was written, in your opinion? When you think about the book of Acts, why was it written, in your opinion?
Opinion, I think, is for us to know the work of the disciples, what they did.
For us to know the work of the disciples, what they did. Okay, yeah. Yeah, I'll take that. Yeah, it is. Yes.
For me, it's about the history of the church, the starting up of the church, and the formation of the church.
How the church began and how the church was formed. Because Jesus said, I'll build my church, but the gates of hell will not prevail against it. But we never saw the building of the church until Jesus died and ascended. Then the disciples pressed into that vision of building the church. Good. Anyone else? Why was the book written, in your opinion?
I think about, you know, the power of God.
About the power of God. Okay, yes.
Because if we read in Acts 1.
Yes. Yes.
We shall receive power. Therefore, they were telling us that, you know, there's power in seeking God, something like that. I don't know. But just about power.
Yes. Yeah, and we saw the power of the Holy Spirit over the power of the devil. You know, you know what's interesting? When the scripture says there, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in all Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. That tells us that actually there exist different levels of power, different types and different levels of power. So when you see demonic activity manifested, it is manifesting as a result of certain type of power. So the Bible says in the book of Luke, I will give you power that you may step on serpents and scorpions. Okay? Paul says that I pray, he said, about my needs before the Father, from whom his own heaven and earth derive his name, his family and heaven and earth derive his. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he will strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being. So there's different types of power, but we understand that Jesus says in Matthew 28, all power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. So the utmost power resides in Christ. But there is other powers. Or there are other powers. So we should not be surprised that another power does something. But residing in you and me is the greatest power. So he says, greater is he who is in me, in us. Greater is the power who is in us. You know, we can talk a lot about that because I say, well, okay, if the power is that great, how comes I'm not seeing it? Well, one thing I would say is you could have electric in your house if you don't switch on the switch. Okay. All right. Praise God. Yes. Thank you. Okay. Just one sec. One sec, please, Deacon Naomi.
When we talk about power, sometimes you have to go through a situation to know if it truly that, you know, that power is there. Mm-hmm. But we have to go through a situation to see if we truly going to exercise that power. That.
Okay. I'm glad you corrected yourself. Yes. 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 It's in crisis time, generally speaking, that the power in us tends to manifest. So Pastor Grace was talking about what she's been through in her life and how God has sustained her. Part of what she's experienced when she went through crisis is the power of God that kept her. I actually think it's power that keeps you single. Oh, glory to God. I really think so. It's power that keeps you single. Because the opposite of not being single means you succumb to weakness of the flesh. Who doesn't want to be hugged? Yeah, but with the hugging comes the package. It is power that keeps you. Okay, all right. Thank you.
Yeah. In Acts 2, we saw the manifestation of the promise Christ gave to the disciples regarding the Holy Spirit.
Yes. Yeah.
And also the salvation, the beginning of the salvation Christ, the death of Christ.
That's right.
To all mankind.
That's
because
right.
After the Holy Spirit has come and Peter has spoken, he spoke to all nations.
Yeah.
There are nations, different nations there.
Gathered there.
He witnessed to them in their
That's
own
right.
language through the Holy Spirit.
That's correct.
So that salvation, the death of Christ,
yeah.
So the first manifestation to all nations.
Yes.
Acts chapter 2.
Yes. So we can see, yeah, thank you. Yes, actually, we can also say that some of these people were the ones who took the gospel to Africa too, because we have Libya. Yeah, Egypt. Yeah. Okay. All right. Yes. I'm not quite sure what did that. Okay. Yeah. Why was it written and what we would say? Well, the church is not against Rome. It's the Jews that are against the church. Now that is Rome against the church. Rome didn't quite care. The only time Romans care is if you say that there's another king. Because Caesar was supposed to be the supreme king. Yeah, whichever Caesar. Caesar Nero is the Caesar is the title, the king title. So, you know, but they were not against Christianity, as long as it didn't bother them. But the Jews in particular were against Christianity because in their mind, the law of Moses should still be maintained as the laws of God. So they never got salvation through Christ. Okay, some people say, actually, I think, you know, one of the person we quote very much in our Bible study, David Pawson, will tell you that it was written as a defense to Paul. Or for Paul. Okay, to whom was the book written? We know why it was written, but to whom was it written?
The church?
Yeah, I would say to the church, to the local and universal church. Actually, from the book of Acts, we begin to understand the concept of the local church and the universal church. There is, particularly if we think about Acts 15, there was a problem in Antioch. Antioch was a local church. But Paul and Barnabas came to Jerusalem to come and air out what that problem was. That they came to the church universal. Because those people in Jerusalem were resigning to Jerusalem. They were seen to be the pillars of the church. So when you say the church in Jerusalem, that was like the headquarters of Christianity then. So there is a church local and there is a church universal. But God expects us all to function first in the church local. Kind of like one-to-one discipleship, if you like. When the book was written, well, I'm not quite sure, but I have a map here that probably would help us. I think I borrowed Dick and Jennifer's map right here. So we see the book of Acts written at some point after the book of Luke, in between the book of John. But what's always interesting for me was that all these letters were written before the book of Acts was written. And all these letters were written before the Gospels were written. And Paul didn't know he was writing the Bible. That always amazes me. That's so touching. When God is going to use you to do something amazing, he's not going to tell you. He will just expect you to operate normally. And through that normal occurrence, God turns that to something supernatural. You will notice that some of the events in your life that have been very significant, you were just doing something normal. This is normal. Just do normal stuff. But then it becomes, you know, significant. I had a couple once. They used to come here. They were saying they were trying for a child. I said, stop trying. I said, what? I said, yeah, stop trying. Just enjoy each other. Because that's how it works. But if you say, it's clock time now. Come on. The pressure of it is too huge that the body just shuts down or goes into a mechanical mode. Because we as human beings, the way that God tends to work with us is, you know, I mean, I remember Pastor and Pastor Unke when they decided that, okay, you know what, child or no child, let's serve God. When we get to heaven, we ask God why we didn't have children. Praise the Lord. Okay, that's the end of that chapter. Praise God. Let's move on. So they moved on. But they didn't. Because God said, now that you've moved on, I can move in. So it's amazing. That's their testimony. They tried all kinds of stuff until they decided that, okay, we're not doing anything anymore than what we do naturally. So that's it. No more going anywhere. We're not getting any prayer. We don't want anybody praying for us. We're not interested. People can pray, they can pray. But we're not coming out. We're not declaring that we're childless. We're not saying anything anymore. That's it, done. We'll get to heaven, you know. And, you know, Chosen came along. So you find out that just normal, just writing a letter. Just visiting somebody. Sometimes you go to visit somebody, and it's in that visit you say something very significant. Because you go to visit. Because these letters here are like our own visits. Oh, my sister, I'm just dropping by. Oh, yeah, you're at home. Okay, praise God. Let's pray. So, some helpful facts that we learn from the book of Acts itself. Abraham's crossing, you know, Abraham's crossing, meaning Abraham crossed through two different seas, meaning baptism, David's fulfilled destiny, Israel is the wilderness. Israel in the wilderness is a type of church. Israel in the wilderness was a type of church. We learned that from the book of Acts. We learned that God seekers, this is important, because some of us, we need to know this. God seekers are not born again believers. Give me an example of who I mean from the book of Acts. God seekers, but they were not born again. So, also in the book of Acts, the actions of angels. So, tell me some actions of angels in the book of Acts. What did angels do in Acts?
They
apart from deliver. You can't say deliver. No, you can't say pardon, deliver. No. I'll be like, John Sepan, no. Jevudi, no. Jevudi, no. Yeah, that's it. Am I correct? Yeah. That speaks a little bit of French. Jevudi, no. No. Absolutely no. Absolument pas. It's strong. One of my very good friends back in the day was French. Spent a lot of time together. Actions of angels.
Prison.
Deliverance from prison. Okay. Okay.
Hold on, Silas.
Peter and the apostles.
Yes.
And Peter, yes. Paul and Silas, the Bible just tells us that the foundation of the temple shook. Okay. We don't know. Well, that was the angel underneath shaking it. We don't know. Or God just said, yeah, didn't tell us. Yeah. Okay, what else? Thank you. That's really good, Pastor Grace. Anything else? What else did angels do in the book of Acts? Angels did a lot of things. Angels. Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who inherit salvation? Last verse in Hebrews chapter 1. We see the manifestation right here. About judge. The angels judge. Who did they judge? Who did they judge? Yes.
They only carried out God's judgment.
On
evildoers.
No. I want to know who they carried the judgment on in the book of Acts.
Oh, yeah. We could say Ananias and Sapphira.
No.
Maybe? No?
That didn't specifically tell us. That's Peter decided on that. But there's a judgment they carried out.
Saul's conversion?
Saul's conversion, no. No. That's the Lord. No. They judged Herod. An angel of the Lord came, struck Herod, and worms ate him. Remember? When the people of Syria went to Herod through Blastus, his aide, and they said, oh, this is not the voice of man, but the voice of God. Straight away, an angel came and struck Herod down, and he was eaten by worms. Yeah? Okay. So, let me give you some more stuff. Delivered Peter from prison, Acts 5, Acts 12. Spoke to people, Acts 8. The angel said to Philip, go to the road that leads from Jerusalem to Gaza. Destroy the enemies of God, Acts 12. Angels gave reassurance in Acts 27. Remember that? Where Paul was traveling on the voyage, and he saw an angel that came to him. He said, the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve, said to me, nothing will happen to you, Lord. You know, it will not result in death, right? That's an angel that spoke to him. Acts 27. I'm moving fast now. What about three odd things that demonic angels did? Those were good angels we're talking about. These were angels of God is what we're talking about just now. What about three things? A title of these three things that demonic angels did in the book of Acts. Yes, one of them.
The prophecy about the witch that say, come and see Paul and Paul. Yeah, because she prophesied through the ministration of demonic angels.
Yes, demons. I'm going to talk about that in a moment. Thank you. That was that. Yes. Acts 16. What else? Yeah, the sons of Sceva. Demons beat people. Demons beat the seven sons of Sceva. They beat them. Can you imagine a demon beating somebody until they're naked? That was interesting. That's odd. Another thing is demons also have desire for power. Somebody operating under demonic influence said, you know what, you to give me this power so that whoever I lay hands on will also receive the Holy Ghost. And Peter said, your money perish with you. So, Acts 8. Then, of course, this is odd. I said, demon speaking in quote unquote truth. What that girl was saying was true. These guys are from God. They're speaking the way to salvation. But you don't want demons to be speaking on your behalf, man. Yeah. Even if they're saying the truth. Because somewhere along the line, they're going to twist it. Yes.
Is that similar to the demon-possessed man? Jesus cast the demons out into the pigs.
That's right.
Because he said, this is the Son of God. Is it the time to torment us?
Yes.
He was speaking. Yes. He acknowledged Christ.
Yes.
And the power.
Do you know why they were acknowledging Christ? Because they wanted him killed before his time. That's why he said, shut up. Don't say nothing. Because then the Jews can attack him. And then, you know, try and bring his ministry to an end before God's time. That's why I said they shouldn't talk. I asked myself a question here where I thought about demons beating people. I don't hear that today, but I hear people who do deliverance in particular being tired. They feel really shattered after they go to cast out the devil. And I don't you know, I don't understand that. I just don't understand it. Because Jesus wasn't tired when he cast out devil. But I've heard stories of people casting out a devil all day. And one time, I went to a church. I'm not going to mention names. I went to a church and I found them chaining. They chained people. They put somebody in chains, tied to a pole. And I said, what's going on there? I said, we're doing deliverance. I said, what kind of deliverance is this? Well, if we don't tie him up, he will hurt himself or hurt somebody. I went away thinking, I'm still not sure what to think. Should they leave this guy out to hurt himself and hurt someone else? My answer will be no. Should he be chained? My answer is no. So until the demon is cast out of him, what do we do? Should the demon be cast out of him by a word? Yes, I agree. But they've tried. It hasn't quite worked yet. So what do we do? You know something? I prefer those people than the ones who sit in church and don't do nothing. At least they're trying. They will get results more than the person who hears, let's go cast out demon and says, me, no. Because I've asked someone to come with me to go cast out. Someone called us, I've told this story. Someone called us one day, said, I think I have demons. I said, we're coming. What's your address? Give us your address. So I turned around to someone in my office and said, what that phone call? I said, what's that? I said, some guy said, he's got demons. I said, let's go cast out the devils. Come on. Pastor, no. I'm not going. And he didn't come with me. He just did it. I was so surprised. I'm like, come. He said, no. Maybe because he's had stories of people casting out demons and it's taking all day and all that. Or the demons jump from that person and jump into him. I don't know. But or the demon beats him like his sons of Sceva. I don't know. But it's really odd. So, yeah, I'll just leave that with you. Younger that followed Paul. So, okay. Also, the book of Acts is marked with supernatural miracles, handkerchief from the body of Paul, Peter's shadow, Eutychus' resurrection. Myself today, third story. Somebody who fell from the third story. What about the head? Is the head not cracked? Did Paul scoop his brain and put it back in there? Not sure. But hey, guy's resurrected. Dorcas resurrection, lame man walk, Aeneas healed. You know, we need some of this stuff. That's one of the reasons why reading the book of Acts is a bit of a double-edged sword for me. I get excited. I'm like, the other part of it is, God, what's the matter with me? It's like, when, Lord? We'll tackle one of those today. Peter delivered from prison. Paul delivered from prison. You will notice in all this, you know, both Peter and Paul did similar miracles, just like Elijah and Elisha. Very similar types of miracles. All right. Okay. Any questions so far? I want to get into one lesson. I think I only do one lesson today. Book of Acts. Any thoughts? Okay, shall I move on? Okay, great. My lesson today, I want to talk about signs and wonders. I was challenged with this. You know, I was listening to the book of Acts today, and I came to the point where Stephen was talking about the journey of the children of Israel. And he said, concerning Moses, who did many signs and wonders. I'm like, whoa! Even back in the old covenant, signs and wonders are supposed to follow anybody that God sends. Oh. So I'm like, Lord! I mean, I've seen some signs and wonders, and it's like, yeah, praise God, but there's still more that I want to see. So I'm thinking, Lord, how do we really do this? I'm like, Holy Spirit, give me one strategy, just one thing that we can change today. Just one thing. If we can change just one thing today, form a new habit today, perhaps we start moving back on that road. Now, John 12, Jesus hears about somebody sick, and he says, this sickness will not result in death. So, you know, no need to worry about it, you know. But the guy died. But because he had said, this sickness will not result to death, when he goes to raise Lazarus, he's still thinking about what he had said. Let me give you another one. I ask myself a question. When you read that passage about Eutychus in Acts 19, the Bible clearly tells us that when Eutychus fell down, he was picked up dead. Right? So my question is, the first people that rushed downstairs, what was in their head? He said, if this guy fell from third story, oh God. They're going downstairs though, to confirm what's in their heart about him. You don't get this. Okay, let me say it again. When they saw, everybody saw the young man sitting there dozing. It's like, this guy is started sleeping. Anyway, we're listening to Paul's talk on and on and on. All the head was, boof. He's like, oh, Eutychus, oh my God, Eutychus. So they're rushing downstairs, oh my God, Eutychus, ah. So they're going downstairs saying, Eutychus is, oh God, he's dead. Oh my God, Eutychus. Eutychus. Oh God, Eutychus. He's dead. So Paul said, what's the guy? Oh, God, oh, really? Okay. What? He's not dead. The guy's alive. He's, wow. God, help me, Lord. What made him say that? And the others couldn't. It's a thought for us. Acts 3. Notice what Peter and John told that guy. Look at us. Look at us. Okay, woman of God, look at me. Silver or gold, I do not have. But I got something. What I have, I give you. Rise up and walk. Ugh. We'll start to answer that question tonight. I think these guys, they have an expectation. And I'm going to prove that to us tonight. I'm going to use Brakuni as an example. Acts 14, Paul is preaching. He looked at a guy. He says, he saw that he had faith to be healed. And he said, rise up. And the guy jumped up and walked. That's a lame guy in Acts 14. Acts 20. Yeah, that's Eutychus in Acts 20. So now, what is this? What are we talking about here? This is what we're talking about. How do we start? We got to start with an expectation. Expectation, very important. You cannot see anything unless you expect. I remember one time I prayed with Sister Juliet. I saw her, it's a couple of years ago now or something. I saw her vacuuming. And she was like, poof, poof. And I said, what's the matter with you? She said, I've had this pain on my shoulder. Remember, I remember that day. She had this pain on her shoulder. And in fact, all her friends have said, she used to go to the gym at that point. All her friends have said she should go to the doctor. But I don't know why. She said she'll make an appointment on Monday. She's going to the doctor. I said, okay, before you go, doctor, let me pray with you. She said, don't worry, I'll go to the doctor. I said, no. Let me pray first, then you can go doctor after if you want. So we started praying, and I'm like, okay, put your hand up. No, I can't. It's hurting me. I said, okay, we'll keep praying. So I keep laying hands on her and praying and speaking words of faith. So she's still hurting. She cannot move her hand up. But after a while, she began to move her hand up. And she said, Pastor, you know, I can move more than this now. I said, okay, praise God, we got something. Okay, move your hand up again, praying. Move your hand up again, she moved. Then suddenly, she just ran out of the room. She ran down the corridor, called one of her friends, said, you're not going to believe this. That pain I have is gone. Look, I can do this. The friend was like, what? I've seen some things that I know that, my God, yeah, you know. But I tell you what, though, it starts with an expectation. So what am I saying here? I'm saying we've got to cultivate this habit of expectation. Let me ask you this. You came today. Now, I'm going to ask you to put your hand up. You came today. You spent a few minutes saying to yourself, man, I'm going Bible study today. I must get something. My life must change today. I must hear something today that will change my life. How many of us did that today? You find out that most of us don't do it. Do you understand? We just come. You say, well, you know, I'm going to upset you because you're thinking, hey, but at least I'm here. Yeah, praise God. Well, it's more than that. You know what? If all of us, and I'm saying this, but all of us, if all of us spent a few minutes, not long, saying, you know what, man, we get to Bible study today. God, And I've read or I've not read. But God, today you will show me something in that word today. Because I know you, Holy Spirit, you can just show me something. And I'm going to get excited. Tonight is my own night. Me too. I'm going to get excited tonight. Then you come. Let me tell you something. To prove this, I tried it the other day when Jennifer was going to teach. I said, you know what? I've been coming to this Bible study now, and I'm just being cool. I said, I don't want to be cool today. Oh, God, I want to hear something. I sat on the edge of my seat. I didn't sit back. I sat forward. So first of all, my posture changed just because I said that. So now, we come. Even if we do it, has it become a habit that we do every time? You will notice, I don't know if you notice, if I send you a birthday message, I don't send general birthday messages. I made up my mind years ago. I'm not sending, if I'm not going to send, I won't send anything. But maybe I'm not sending, just go and find this. Mm-mm. I will pray. I'll ask God for a word. I receive the word and I call you. Then I call you and say, this thus says the Lord. That's it. I'm not sending some birthday thing here and there. No. It's a decision. It's an expectation. So when I hear somebody's birthday, a commitment comes upon me. So if I don't hear, I don't hear. The only reason why I can get that message is because I just ask the Holy Spirit. Period. Not because I'm some, you know, pastor, because I do, hey, but you're a pastor. It doesn't work like that. Here's another thing. I come to prayer meeting saying, today my prayers must be answered. You know, as I wrote this, I thought to myself, yeah, we probably do this more when we're in trouble. But we don't do it as a habit. What we're going to carry to praying for the sick? I'm going to show you in a moment. Now, let me show you. Okay, let me tell you one more thing. What do you do when you arrive? Okay, here's this. What do you do when you arrive here genuinely tired? You're genuinely coming from work and you're tired. It's not because you sat at home. No, you went to work. Your work is demanding. You've stood all day. You are genuinely tired. Do you know what? That's not good enough. You say, yeah, but pastor, I'm tired. But I'm telling you, you are not as tired as you think. I want you to understand, you're fighting two battles as a Christian. You're fighting the flesh and you're fighting the devil. And if he cannot stop you from coming to a meeting, he wants to stop you from getting the fullness. As long as you come and you don't really get much, the devil is okay. It's okay with that. That's not a problem. So you go to church, you come, you don't get anything. That's fine. I'm going to teach you what to do. You are better than the one who was tired and didn't come. I agree. So before you go, but pastor, I'm here. Praise the Lord. You're better than the one who was tired and stayed at home. You're better than that. But still, that's not it. This is it. But you can still be robbed of the fullness of God if you do not have expectation. What are you expecting when you come? What do you think? What are you expecting? Do you have an expectation you come in? Do you know why it looks like I don't have issues? Do you know why it looks like that? I cannot afford to come and be looking drained and tired as some of us can come. So Brakule came in one day looking like that. I'm going to use him as an example, I said. I even got your name in black. Bold. You know what I did to him? I said, okay, you're leading prayer. He came in genuinely tired. I'm not saying he wasn't. He was tired, so I said, okay, take, lead prayer. Okay, Brother Dennis is leading. After Brother Dennis is you. You are leading. This happened, I think, about 2 weeks ago or so, when we learned about the children. I mean, he led some prayers. I'm like, whoa. He basically took what he was saying. Was it you prayed as well? Did you pray? Yeah. It was Brother Dennis, Brakule, you, and then me. Yeah. But then started hit that children thing or hit something close to that. He came along and just took it. But he was tired. But you know what? I decided I'm not going to allow him to be robbed of his expectation. So I said, no, you are going to lead prayer. And the moment he was told to lead prayer, his expectation changed to, I'm not going to stand here and just be looking tired. So I'm going to have to pray. So where did the energy come from? I put it to you that energy was there. If you yield to your flesh, you lose. It's 1 hour. You can pray for 1 hour. You can listen for 1 hour. You can expect that I'm coming. I'm going to be a blessing to somebody today. I just want to bless somebody. God, give me something. I want to bless somebody. It's really that simple. So, I asked him to lead prayer. He led prayer. So sometimes, please, don't resist when you're tired and somebody says, still do it. It's your opportunity to get out of that tiredness. Because when we say we're tired, it's not like we're not tired. I agree with you that you're tired. I agree with you that, yeah, you might have what we call a long day. That's very true. There's no denying that. But you are here. Come on, receive 100%. Don't get 10%. So now, here's the deal. If we have this habit that I take 1 or 2 minutes, I remind myself what I want. Before you come, that's what I do. Whether I'm going to stay in my office, I'm going to be walking up the stairs. God, today, man, I go, man, Lord, thank you, Holy Ghost. I got to minister today. Praise God. Paul said, besides, I face my daily concern for the churches. Who feels weak? And I do not feel weak or do not inwardly burn. That means he's got his own issues. But he goes to the church and says, man, God is good. Rejoice. And I say it again, rejoice. How can he say that? He decided that. Let me tell you something. That's what all the men of God that you see on TV that look like they don't have issues, that's what they do. They get to their little corner and they say, God, your people are out there. I know I'm tired, but you got to give me something to say, Lord. And because God is faithful and he wants to bless you and me, he gives them something to say because they ask. You take 1 or 2 minutes, you say to yourself, every time, you just cultivate this habit. It doesn't have to be long, 30 seconds, 10 seconds, whatever it is. You're coming up the stairs. If you forget and you get to the door, you stand by that door and say, God, I got to receive something today and I got to be a blessing today. Praise God. I will be a blessing today and I will be blessed today in Jesus' name. Your attitude, you have just changed your attitude straight away. You have an expectation. Straight away, that's it. Those few words just change you, period. So, what do you want God to do? What do you want? What do you want to learn? Think like the leader that you are. Remember, we said in Matthew 5, you know, blessed are the poor in spirit. Remember, I said that on Sunday. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are the poor in spirit. You're poor in spirit because you're a leader. That's what leaders do. Leaders say they must be a blessing. You can say that too. We can all do this stuff. Now, guess what? If that's my attitude already, when I want to pray for the sick, I'm going to start praying with an expectation that when I lay hands, I go see something. I've got to see, God, there's got to be something. That's what you are not a respecter of persons. So, you know what I do? Before I pray for you, I'll pause. I will psych myself up. You can call it what you like. I will tell myself that, God, when I pray for that person, they've got to be healed. Whether I see it or not, I will tell myself that before I begin. I will quickly tell myself that before I begin. So that's what I'm talking about. You pause, you believe, then you pray. You pause, you tell yourself, Lord, I know that you have already healed us. Thank you, Jesus. For greater is in me than is in that sickness. That sickness has to go. So, then you pray. But my question is, so how do you pray? I said, you pray like it's already done. Don't pray this prayer, oh God, come and do it. Don't do it. Don't say it. Don't say that. Just don't say it. That's an old covenant prayer. Don't pray that. Don't say, come and do it. You can say, come and manifest. You can say manifest, not come and do it. When Jesus died on the cross, he has done his own part of it. Silver or gold, I do not have. Now that Jesus has died and resurrected, I now have something. So that which I have, I give to you. Stand up and walk in that name that I believe in. That's what Peter said, that he didn't say like that, but that's what he meant. There's somebody in our church right now. If anybody is going to see more miracles, he'll be the person to see it. Guess who that is? Before you, I'll say maybe Brother Dennis. Do you know why? Simple. He prays for more people than all of us. That's all. And every time you keep praying for more people, that's just it. That's the secret. That's why Benny Hinn gets more results than most people. I know they publicize the results he doesn't get, but they don't publicize the results he gets. He gets more results than is better than doctor. He said, yeah, but somebody died. Number of people who die in the hands of doctors, you'll be amazed. I'm telling you that in the hands of doctors every week, at every day, at least jumbo size number of people are dying in the hands of doctors. Misdiagnosis, failure to, they take out something they're not supposed to touch. They give up early because they want to go to their dinner. They argue with the nurse when the nurse is saying, don't do that. Said, how dare you talk to me? They're doing that on the theater table where somebody's life is at stake. But anyway, that's not where we're going here. But the point is, pray like it's already done. Expect to see a change. Just expect. They say, well, what if it doesn't happen? Just keep expecting. That's your own job. Your job is to keep expecting. And please, remember, sometimes I said, never speak contrary to what you want to see. If you do, catch yourself and rephrase. Yeah, like Sister Matt did. Yeah, that's what you do. That's not right. Change it. That's all you need to do. You know what? If we keep doing this, we'll see miracles. Amen?
Amen.
Just this small shift. I just want you, before you pray for somebody, just tell yourself, there's got to be a change. By stripes, we were healed. Just tell yourself one scripture. That's just one scripture, that's it. Then pray. Before you come into any meeting, just say to yourself, God, you got to make me a blessing today. And I've got to be blessed today. Amen. Thank you, Lord. There's more blessings than God can ever give. So don't worry about it. The blessing will finish. Can't finish. Just those few seconds changes you. Lord, I'm feeling tired, but I know in you there is strength, so I receive strength. I'm going to go there and I'm going to pray. It's only 1 hour. I'm going to pray for this 1 hour and I'm going to get results in Jesus' name. Then you come up. I'm going to Bible study. Lord, I've got to hear something that's going to change my life. And I've got to say something that's going to impact somebody's life in Jesus' name. Today is Sunday service. Lord, when I get up there to the service, I'm going to be a blessing to somebody. And somebody is going to bless me also in Jesus' name. I don't care what happens. I'm just going to be blessed and I'm going to bless somebody. Even if the praise and worship is rubbish, you will still feel blessed. If the preacher didn't preach what they're supposed to preach, you, because of your expectation, you will hear something. Because your heart is open, God will just say something. So I'm going to stop there. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Did we get something tonight? Did we get something tonight? Did we get something tonight? Praise God. Final comment.
Just to ascertain to the expectation, I used to practice that, and it works. It works. I used to, any gathering I'm going as pertaining to Christians, especially church. As I'm going to church today, I must receive something. God, I must receive something, and it puts me. It kind of like alerts. So as you said, you sat at the edge.
Yeah.
It puts me like that. All those times I remember just saying, even when we were at St. Albans.
Yeah.
And the little things. So after everything, I search myself. What have I got?
That's right.
Because I came with an expectation. So
that's
it's
right.
Like I search my mind.
Yeah.
What have I got?
Yeah.
And it could be something small and I'll hold on to it.
That's right.
I would say now it's coming to me that was the beginning of my groove, kind of.
That's right.
My groove, because I was getting little by little here.
That's right.
And there.
Yeah.
So it works.
Yeah. Yeah. And the salvation thing that Sister Victoria was looking at when I was talking about, that's how you get it back. That's how you reignite it. Because what used to happen when we're coming to church, when we first got saved, we used to have expectation. But somewhere along the line, because we have come so many times, we can take it for granted. And we forget. But you just started. You've not seen anything. Amen. Father, we're so thankful for your word today. Thank you for what we have learned. Help us to practice and put this as a habit for us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give to the Lord and